All right, so we're going to do a little bit more with summation manipulation. And again, I'd like to especially thank Concrete Mathematics by those folks, Knuth and Graham and Potashnik. They're kind of amazing, and their book is crazy. And eventually, one day in my life, I'm going to understand everything in it. Okay, so they do this thing where they're going to do this summation of, I don't know what you call it. Hold on, I'll make it pretty. Okay, so they have the summation S sub N, where it's going from 1 less than or equal to j, strictly less than k, less than or equal to n, of 1 over k minus j. Okay, so for me to make it make sense, my brain doesn't work like this. And apparently that's because other people are infinitely smarter and stuff. Ah, come back here. So I have to rewrite that for it to make sense. Okay, so remember what we can do is we can like, okay, so if I cover up the J, I can see that one way I can interpret this is I could say that K is going, definitely has to be less than or equal to N, and then the question is, can it get all the way down to 1? Well, no, it can't get to 1 because it has to be greater than something that also has to be something. So it has to be greater than 1, and then J itself is going to be controlled by being between 1 and K. So that's one way of thinking about it. The other way that I can think about it is I can cover up the k, and then I can say, okay, so then that means that 1 is less than or equal to j, and then j has to be strictly less than n because this is a strictly less than. And then if I reveal the k, then that means that k goes between j, just strictly greater than j and less than or equal to n. Okay, so I guess it really doesn't matter which way you're going to do this. I'm going to go with the second one because I like to put J's first for no particular reason, except because it's alphabetical and stuff. All right, so that means that J is going to start at 1, and it can't go all the way to N. But I'm assuming I'm working with integers, even though I didn't tell you all that. I'm working with integers, so there. It can't go all the way to N, but it can go to N minus 1. And that's because of the less than sign, okay? So if it was less than or equal to, I can go straight to n. And then here, k, now it can't start at j because it's, again, greater than, strictly greater than, so it has to start at j plus 1, but it can go all the way to n of 1 over k minus j. And believe it or not, that's just infinitely easier for me to understand. So, you know, that takes a while to catch up with these people when they're doing their math. All right, this doesn't actually help that much though, because I'm like, still don't know what's going on. And so one of our strategies is just to start trying to see what this might be. I'm just gonna start using a random number. So I'm just gonna pick 3. So what would this be like if, for funsies, what would this look like if n was equal to 3? All right, so then that would mean that j would go from 1 to 2, and k would go from j plus 1 to 3 of 1 over k minus j. All right. So I'd say, all right, so when j is 1, then k goes from 2 to 3. So that's, well, actually, let me write it fancy because this isn't just for me. This is for y'all. I'm doing this for y'all. So k is going from 2 to 3. So that's k of 2 minus 1, oh, hold on, I'll write the whole thing, of over, so k minus 1. All right, there we go. So that would be 1 over 2 minus 1 plus 1 over 3 minus 1. All right, and then j is equal to 2, so that means that k is going from 3 to 3 of 1 over k minus 2. So that's, right? I think so. K minus 2. So that would be 1 over 3 minus 2. All right, this is not very exciting. So that gives me 1 over 2 minus 1 is 1, plus 1 over 3 minus 1 is 2, plus 1 over 3 minus 2 is 1, and so that gives me 5 halves. Okay, well, I can't say that that really helped any. Maybe I can try and think about this the other way, perhaps. I guess if I flipped it around to this. I don't think that's going to help writing it in blue. So I think I'm just going to have to get over it. I was kind of hoping that something magic would happen. I'd be like, five halves, so clearly. Yeah, so I guess I've just proven to you that I know how to, like, do basic math. And by basic math, I mean not basic math. anyway, so that was for funsies. I got an answer, which I guess means that eventually if I get a more better simplification of this, I can come back and see if it's still matched, at least in one example. All right, so let's see. I've given up on hoping for wonderful inspiration. So I'm going to go back to J equals 1 to N minus 1, and then K is equal to J plus 1 to N of 1 over K minus J. Now, you know that you've reached a bad point when you're like, let's try to make these summations simpler by referencing calculus. Okay, so you know there's a thing when you're integrating something. Hold on, it's been a long time since I've officially like remembered how to do this. And you have like x1 here and x2 here. Then you can like do a thing where you can add a number here as long as you subtract it from here. You know what I'm talking about? That's like a thing that you do in what's he does. It's like a substitution. Like you do a u sub where you like let u equal x plus k or something like that. Or I guess it'd be more like let, oh, that's what it would be. Okay, so I'm going to do this for real now. So like if you had this function and you didn't know how to take the integral of it, oh, like if you had 1 over, not that you couldn't necessarily take the integral over this, and you'd be like this, and you'd be like, okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to let, and we'll just say it goes from x1 to x2. You'd be like, okay, so I'm going to let u equal x plus 1, and so the upper would be x2 plus 1. No. What would the upper be? X is equal to, yeah, x2 plus 1. All right, and then the lower would be x1 plus 1. And then you do the thing where du is equal to dx. And so you're able to rewrite this as the integral 1 over u du from x2 plus 1 to x1 plus 1. Okay, so something like this. So how can I'm trying to show you where I'm going with this. So like let's call this u2 and let's call this u1. So I could also say, actually I don't need to do that to show you what I'm doing here. That's not necessary. And because it's math and it's integration, right, there's no reason that I can't turn these back into x's again because they're just variables. So I could just go 1 over x dx. All right. So basically what I'm trying to tell you is that this thing and this thing are equal. Okay. So I'm just going to rewrite this over here. So this thing and this other thing here are equal. And so I don't know if this was you, but at some point during calculus, I was like, well, rather than going through this whole process, that I could just say, I'm going to take this and I'm subtract 1 and I'm going to add 1 to both of these and I can just shift it. And I didn't have to worry about changing the d because if I have a ddu on something that just is shifted, I don't have to worry about it. Now, if this whole explanation doesn't make sense because you're not into calculus, that's fine. But basically what we did is anything we did to the inside, we had to undo to the outside. So if I shifted by 1 on the inside, I had to shift by 1 on the outside in the other direction, basically, is where I'm going with this. That these are the same thing and they're just shifted. There's probably a way easier way to explain this, but for some reason, the summation stuff makes sense to me in terms of calculus. Like anything you do to the inside, you have to undo to the outside. So basically the idea is in my heart of hearts, I super duper wish that this stupid summation would start at 1. This one in here. So I wish it was started at 1 and not the stupid j plus 1 thing. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to shift everything. I guess I could have just started with an algebraic shift, but I don't know. For some reason, the calculus route seemed like the most obvious way to go. All right, so I want to get rid of this j. So I'm going to subtract j. And so that means I have to subtract j up here. That way I have the same number of terms. So if this is 5 terms, if I subtract the indices both by the same number, I'll still have 5 terms. So I'm going to subtract n the j from the inside. So that means I'm going to add the j. Hold on, I think I said that wrong. If I'm going to subtract the j from the outside, I need to add the j on the inside. That's where I was going. All right, so basically I keep saying basically, like this is super obvious. It's like basically it's just multiple sums and like kind of like calculus, but not. K equals 1 to n minus j of 1 over k. Wow, that's like a lot prettier than I expected it to be. All right, let me get rid of my like fun adventures in calculus and u substitution because that doesn't make that much sense. Anyway, now maybe this is something you recognize. Maybe. This right here, that's a harmonic series because, you know, like if you have 1 over 1 plus 1 over 2 plus 1 over 3 plus 1 over 4, that's a harmonic series. So that's what we have here. So we can actually replace this. So we'll say, remember that we have this harmonic series that is equal to anything k going from 1 to n of 1 over n, or 1 over k. So that's basically what we have. So we have a harmonic series, but instead of being h sub n, it's h sub n minus j. All right. So this thingy that we have here is equal to the sum of j going from 1 to n minus 1 of the harmonic series n minus j. Okay. That's fun. Now, what this basically means, basically, there's that word again, is let's start at j equals 1. We would say that this is going to look like h of n minus 1 plus h of n minus 2 plus h of n minus 3. And we're going to go doop 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 do all the way to h of n minus, and remember j, what I'm substituting in is j, so minus 1, 2, 3, all the way to n minus 1. So n minus 1. All right, so that's h n minus 1 plus h n minus 2 plus h n minus 3 plus plus h sub 1, right? Because n minus quantity n minus 1 is just 1. So actually what it is it's a sum of a harmonic sequence, which I guess you could have told already, but I'm just going to write it. So basically it's just in a different order, not a different order, it's just in descending order. And I'm just going to rewrite the whole thing in ascending order for no other reason except that my whole goal in life is to make math make more sense to people. And by writing things in ascending order, we naturally think in ascending order. So I could now rewrite this instead of doing this weird j equals 1 to n minus 1, n minus j thing. I can say, actually, really what this is I can pick any index that I want. And if it makes you feel better to, like, say j, you had your chance and you decided to be obnoxious, I can let it be I. From I going from 1 to n minus 1, of h sub I, because that's just a little bit easier for us to count. It's easier to count up than it is to count down. So that's kind of a fun little one that they do in the book that I got to play with for a while before I finally understood what was going on. And if we kind of want to play with it, we had that example earlier where we said what happens whenever n is equal to 3, then we would have I going from 1 to 2 of h sub I. So that would be the harmonic sequence of 1 plus the harmonic sequence of 2. So the harmonic sequence of 1 being just 1 over 1, and the harmonic sequence of 2 being 1 over 1 plus 1 over 2, which gives us the 5 halves that we have before. So, I mean, that's not really a proof by induction or anything, but it's at least a demonstration that I probably didn't drop any negatives in a way that this particular example revealed.